Okay, great. So if you remember from the last class, we studied about how we are collecting data before starting any kind of analysis or any kind of model building or any kind of maybe you say you want to do any report making or simple trend analysis or anything like that. So there are ways how we collect the data, because data is the most important step while you are doing any kind of analysis or building model or anything. So here we chalked out some of the steps which you can do before we actually start our analysis, because once your data is correct, you can actually build your strategy and analysis of that. And if your data is not correct, say the effort you have spent for the 1 month or 2 months while building your strategy or model or anything will go absolutely waste, because the underlying data is wrong, it has not been treated well. Then we talked about the data dictionary. So data dictionary talks about the individual variables which are present in the data, their definitions, what are their meanings, and what they represent to, and how you're actually using them within your complete data set. Now, a very important part while collecting data is your missing value imputation. So a lot of time what happens is, when you are receiving a credit card spend data for say 1 million of your complete customer base of say 15 or 20 million, there you will say for some customers, some of the values would be missing. Say for example, some people do not have the state in which they reside that is not populated against their name. Sometimes their FICO scores may not be available, or any kind of numeric or character variable is missing against some of the values out of those 20 million records. So as your as an analyst, it is very important for you that when you are starting or building your data, you complete your data. Now, usually what happens is, if you have 5 to 10% of the missing values in the data, you can treat them yourself. So there are different methods which are there in the statistical or econometrics methodology, where you can do the best estimate of the missing information and put the values against that and further continue your analysis. But if your data contains huge amount of missing value, say 15% or 20% of a particular variable values are not there, or 50% is missing, then it's a problem. Then you have to approach the person who has provided you the data or the data team, and you have to get it corrected. So as an analyst, as a statistician, as an econometrician, your job is to make the data best fit for the analysis. And why is that so? Because especially when you're building models, you will be getting data on a yearly or monthly basis, and you will be running the same models with the same equation on the fresh data which you get. If you do not treat your data in a proper way or in a similar manner, your model will go burst. Your model will not give you the similar kind of results which they were giving while you finalize your model. And then there would be questions on your modeling methodology and how you have prepared the model. Now, when you talk about missing value input imputations, there are different methods with which you can fill up those missing values. Very simple method is, you input the missing values with a zero, so that whenever you are running any kind of procs or any kind of analysis or any kind of statements on your data, it does not consider it as missing and it considers the value. And there are different methods as well, like you replace your missing values with the median value of a particular variable, a mean value or mode value. These are based on the type of data you are seeing and the kind of business judgment you have while you are seeing your data. Also, what you can do is, sometimes you can divide your data into different segments and then can impute the missing value. So for example, you consider few variables together. Say you have you have an information of state against the name or account ID, and you have the information of city as well. Now, sometimes it can happen that against a person, the value of city is populated, but state is not populated. So that is pretty simple. You can check that that particular city lies in a particular segment or state, and you can populate that value. But what happens if both city and state are missing? Then, for example, if you have a particular segmentation method existing in your data, or you want to segment your data by combining few variables like FICO scores, credit card outstandings, number of products, credit line, you identify few variables on the basis of which you can segregate your data. And if you see that out of those 20 million customers, those 2 million customers lie in one particular segment. Okay. And then when you did the segmentation, you use 4 or 5 variables. If any of value of one variable is missing against any of the account ID, you can populate the same. Apart from that, there are different methods, like you can create some dummy value, you can input in impute using bivariate graphs, and there are n number of methods with which you can do the missing value imputation. But guys, remember, it is very important, do not leave your data as blank. Lot of times while you're actually working, people might know, people might not know, or they are in hurry, they would leave their data with the missing value. That might lead to instability of your models, or you know, that would impact the reusability of your analysis or models. Another treatment you need to do while you're doing any kind of analysis or model building is the outlier treatment. So outlier, as the name suggests, is a value which outlies the population distribution. I'll give you a real example which I have worked upon. So say we were building a model, and the credit line which we were seeing for credit card for individual customers have a percentile distribution. So for some of the cases, the credit line was shown as negative. And for percentile 90, say my credit line was going around, say, $1 million. For percentile 95, my credit line was going till $1.1 million. But when I looked at percentile 99, my value shot up to $100 million. So in my case, this was a data issue. Credit line is the spend limit which you have on your credit card. Say for example, you have a credit card and you spend it on a monthly basis, but it has a limit assigned to it. Say you cannot spend more than 1 lakh in a month. Okay. So as per industry standard, banking standard, the credit lines have limits. Limits in the sense, the range in which you can give it to the customer. So they cannot go to like 100 million or something. So that those are typically data issues. Now, if I leave those values in my data, they will extremely affect my analysis. For example, if you're calculating a simple measure of dispersion like mean, my mean would be highly affected by my outlier values. Or when you have a situation when data is correct, but there are some outlier values. For example, I have 20 million customers who have a spend range between 10K to 1 million. But I have 4 or 5 customers who have done lot of spending on their credit card, which is higher than the usual range where I see my expenditure. This can happen because of some extreme behavior which we observe on the customer's account, which is not a regular one. So whenever you're doing any analysis or any model building, you have to take into account the regular or the common behavior. The outlier behavior needs to be ruled out, because you cannot make a model, cannot build an analysis on a random, on the extreme behaviors. Okay, so there are two types of outliers as we discussed. One is the actual error and one are the genuine outliers. Okay, so outliers can affect your data by giving you a very good result or giving you a very bad results. For example, if your outliers increase your loss rates, then they are bad for your analysis or model building. When you say my outliers are showing a higher number of average spend per customer per month, then outliers are actually giving you more rosy picture than it actually exists. Now, to treat the outliers, there are different treatments. The most common is capping and flooring. So you cap your values at say P95 or P99, and at a lower level you cap it at P5 or P10, and then only the middle part or the interpercentile range you take it for analysis. Then there is exponential smoothing technique. You plot some exponential curves and try to smoothen it out. And then there are some sigma approaches as well. You check sigma, basically how much my value is differentiating from the mean, and then you try to adjust your outlier values. So either you remove your outlier values or you replace them with some different values using different techniques. Okay. So this is how I need to treat my data before starting any analysis or model building. Now, when you are doing a statistical analysis or model building, you have a huge amount of population with you. Say if you have a population of around, so guys, I'm on slide 33, let me know if you cannot see. Okay, so say I have a population of 25 million or 30 million customers. But whenever you're building your strategy or building your model, you always build it on a sample. Usually, when you're doing a modeling, you divide your data into 80-20 ratio or 70-30 ratio. And you build your model only on 70% of the population or 80% of the population. Now, if you try to understand what is the population, what is the sample, you can see with the graph which is at the bottom. So population is a complete set, say 20 million customers. And if you want to take individual samples out of it, they would be just small random chunks out of the data. So the most important thing when you are doing an analysis, you should pull out random samples which are unbiased. So the values which you are pulling out of your data should be pulled randomly. It's not that if a particular state or city is performing well, you take more values or more observations out of it and less observations out of the city which is performing bad. Or if you take more population out of the higher FICO customers and less population or observations out of the lower FICO customers. In that way, you're trying to, affect your final outcome. So that you do not want to do as a statistician, as an econometrician, because you want your strategy or your model to run perfectly for every run you do for the further ones. Okay. So this is a simple way how you can define your sample and population. And any model, any if you have the Basel model or a CCAR model or any model or any strategy, you usually build it on a sample, a random sample, and then you try to check it on the different parts of the population whether my strategy or model is working fine or not. Okay. So guys, any questions till now? Before we move on to the next topic. Okay, great. So for the validation, as I said, we keep a sample of it. We divide the population into 80-20 or 70-30. On 70%, we usually build the model, and the rest 30%, we do the validation of our model. So that is how I segregate my data into two samples.